question. Who of you is using Facebook, Twitter, Diaspora? Ooh. And all of that data you enter there gets to a server, gets into the hand of somebody who's using it. And the next talk is especially about that, because there's also intelligent machines and intelligent algorithms that try to make something out of that data. So the postdoc researcher Jennifer Helsby of the University of Chicago, which works in this intersection between policy and technology, will now ask you the question, to whom would we give that power?
Thanks. Okay, so today I'm going to do a brief tour of intelligent systems and how they're currently used, and then we're going to look at some examples with respect to the properties that we might care about these systems having, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the work that's been done in academia on these topics, and then we'll talk about some promising paths forward. So I want to start with this, Kranzberg's first law of technology. So it's not good or bad, but it also isn't neutral. Technology shapes our world, and it can act as a liberating force or an oppressive and controlling force. So in this talk, I'm going to go towards some of the aspects of intelligent systems that might be more controlling in nature. So as we all know, because of the rapidly decreasing cost of storage and computation, along with the rise of new sensor technologies, data collection devices are being pushed into every aspect of our lives, in our homes, our cars, in our pockets, on our wrists. And data collection systems act as intermediaries for a huge amount of human communication, and much of this data sits in government and corporate databases. So, in order to make use of this data, we need to be able to make some inferences. So one way of approaching this is I can hire a lot of humans, and I can have these humans manually examine the data, and they can acquire expert knowledge of the domain, and then perhaps they can make some decisions or at least some recommendations based on it. However, there's some problems with this. One is that it's slow and thus expensive. It's also biased. We know that humans have all sorts of biases, both conscious and unconscious, and it would be nice to have a system that did not have these inaccuracies. It's also not very transparent. I might not really know the factors that led to some decisions being made. Even humans themselves often don't really understand why they came to a given decision because of their being emotional in nature. And thus, these human decision-making systems are often difficult to audit. So another way to proceed is maybe instead I study the system and the data carefully and I write down the best rules for making a decision, or I can have a machine dynamically figure out the best rules as a machine learning. So maybe this is a better approach. It's certainly fast and thus cheap. And maybe I can construct the system in such a way that it doesn't have the biases that are inherent in human decision making. And since I've written these rules down, or a computer has learned these rules, then I can just show them to somebody, right? And then they can audit it. So more and more decision making is being done in this way. And so in this model, we take data, we make an inference based on that data using these algorithms, and then we can take actions. And when we take this more scientific approach to making decisions and optimizing for a desired outcome, we can take an experimental approach. So we can determine which actions are most effective in achieving a desired outcome. Maybe there are some types of communication styles that are most effective with certain people. I can perhaps deploy some individualized incentives to get the outcome that I desire. And even if I carefully design and experiment with the environment in which people make these decisions, perhaps even very small changes can introduce significant changes in people's behavior. So through these mechanisms and this experimental approach, I can maximize the probability that humans do what I want. So, algorithmic decision making is being used in industry and is used in lots of other areas, from astrophysics to medicine, and is now moving into new domains, including government applications. So we have recommendation engines like Netflix, Yelp, SoundCloud that direct our attention to what we should watch and listen to. Since 2009, Google uses personalized search results, including if you're not logged into your Google account. And we also have algorithmic curation and filtering, as in the case of Facebook newsfeed, Google News, Yahoo News, which shows you what news articles, for example, you should be looking at. And this is important because a lot of people get news from these media. We even have algorithmic journalists. So automatic systems or generate articles about weather, traffic, or sports instead of a human. And another application that's more recent is the use of predictive systems in political campaigns. So political campaigns also now take this approach to predict on an individual basis which candidate voters are likely to vote for, and then they can target on an individual basis those that can be persuaded otherwise. And finally, in the public sector, we're starting to use predictive systems in areas from policing to health to education and energy. So there are some advantages to this. So one thing is that we can automate aspects of our lives that we consider to be mundane using systems that are intelligent and adaptive enough. We can make use of all the data and really get the pieces of information we really care about. We can spend money in the most effective way. And we can do this with this experimental approach to optimize actions to produce desired outcomes. So we can embed intelligence into all of these mundane objects and enable them to make decisions for us. And so that's what we're doing more and more. And we can have an object that decides for us what temperature we should set our house, what we should be doing, etc. So there might be some implications here. We want these systems that do work on this data to increase the opportunities available to us. But it might be that there's some implications that we have not carefully thought through. This is a new area, and people are only starting to scratch the surface of what the problems might be. In some cases, they may narrow the options available to people, and this approach subjects people to suggestive messaging intended to nudge them to a desired outcome. Some people may have a problem with that. Values we care about are not going to be baked into these systems by default. It's also the case that some algorithmic systems facilitate work that we do not like, for example, in the case of mass surveillance. And even the same systems used by different people or organizations have very different consequences. For example, if I can predict with high accuracy, based on, say, search queries, who's going to be admitted to hospital, some people would be interested in knowing that. You might be interested in having your doctor know that. But that same predictive model in the hands of an insurance company has a very different implication. So the point here is that these systems structure and influence how humans interact with each other, how they interact with society, and how they interact with government. And if they constrain what people can do, then we should really care about this. So now I'm going to go to sort of an extreme case just as an example, and that's this Chinese social credit system. And so this is probably one of the more ambitious uses of data that is used to rank each citizen based on their behavior in China. So right now, there are various pilot systems deployed by various companies doing this in China, and they're currently voluntary. And by 2020, a system is going to be decided on, or a combination of the systems that is going to be mandatory for everyone. And so in this system, there are some citizens, and a huge range of data sources are used. So some of the data sources are your financial data, your criminal history, how many points you have on your driver's license, medical information. For example, if you take birth control pills, that's incorporated. Your purchase history. For example, if you purchase games, you're downranked in the system. Some of the systems, not all of them, incorporate social media monitoring, which makes sense if you're a state like China. You probably want to know about political statements that people are saying on social media. And one of the more interesting parts is social network analysis, so looking at the relationships between people. So if you have a close relationship with somebody and they have a low credit score, that can have implications on your credit score. So the way that these scores are generated is secret. And according to the call for these systems put out by the government, the goal is to carry forward the sincerity and traditional virtues and establish the idea of a sincerity culture. So, but wait, it gets better. So there's a portal that enables citizens to look up the citizen score of anyone. And many people like this system. They think it's a fun game. They boast about it on social media. They put their score in their dating profile, because if you're ranked highly, you're part of an exclusive club. You can get VIP treatment at hotels and other companies. But the downside is that if you're excluded from that club, your weak score may have other implications, like being unable to get access to credit, housing, jobs. There are some, there's some reporting saying that even travel visas might be restricted if your score is particularly low. So a system like this for a state is really the optimal solution to the problem of the public. It constitutes a very subtle and insidious mechanism of social control. You don't need to spend a lot of money on police or prisons if you can set up a system where people discourage one another from antisocial acts like political action in exchange for a coupon for a free Uber ride. So there are a lot of legitimate questions here. What protections does user data have in this scheme? Do any safeguards exist to prevent tampering? What mechanism, if any, is there to prevent false input data from creating erroneous inferences? Is there any way that people can fix their score once they're ranked poorly, or does it end up becoming a self-fulfilling prophecy? Your weak score means you have less access to jobs and credit, and now you will have limited access to opportunity. So let's take a step back. So what do we want? So we probably don't want that. But as advocates, we really want to understand what questions we should be asking of these systems. Right now, there's very little oversight. And we want to make sure that we don't sort of sleepwalk our way to a situation where we've lost even more power to these centralized systems of control. And if you're an implementer, you know, we want to understand what can we be doing better. Are there better ways that we can be implementing these systems? Are there values that, as humans, we care about that we should make sure these systems have? So the first thing that most people in the room might think about is privacy, which is, of course, of the utmost importance. We need privacy, and there is a good discussion on the importance of protecting user data where possible. So in this talk, I'm going to focus on the other aspects of algorithmic decision making that I think have got less attention, because it's not just privacy that we need to worry about here. We also want systems that are fair and equitable. We want transparent systems. We don't want opaque decisions to be made about us, decisions that might have serious impacts in our lives. And we need some accountability mechanisms. So for the rest of this talk, we're going to go through each one of these things and look at some examples. So the first thing is fairness. And so, as I said in the beginning, this is one area where there might be an advantage to making decisions by machine, especially in areas where there have historically been fairness issues with decision making, such as law enforcement. So this is one way that police departments use predictive models. So the idea here is police would like to allocate resources in a more effective way, and they would also like to enable proactive policing. So if you can predict where crimes are going to occur or who is going to commit crimes, then you can put cops in those places or perhaps following these people, and then the crimes will not occur. So it's sort of the pre-crime approach. So there are a few ways of going about this. So one way is doing this individual level prediction. So you take each citizen and estimate the risk that each citizen will participate, say, in violence based on some data. And then you can flag those people that are considered particularly violent. So this is currently done. This is done in the US. It's done in Chicago by the Chicago Police Department. And they maintain a heat list of individuals that are considered most likely to commit or be the victim of violence. And this is done using data that the police maintain. So the features that are used in this predictive model include things like, well, things that are derived from an individual's criminal history. So for example, have they been involved in gun violence in the past? Do they have narcotics arrests and so on? But another thing that's incorporated in the Chicago Police Department model is information derived from social network analysis. So who you interact with as noted in police data. So for example, your co-arrestees, when officers conduct field interviews, who are people interacting with, and then this is all incorporated into this risk score. So another way to proceed, which is the method that most companies that sell products like this to the police have taken, is instead predicting which areas are likely to have crimes committed in them. So I take my city, I put a grid down, and then I use crime statistics and maybe some ancillary data sources to determine which areas have the highest risk of crimes occurring in them. And I can flag those areas and send police officers to them. So now let's look at some of the tools that are used for this geographic level prediction. So here are three companies that sell these geographic level predictive policing systems. So Predpol has a system that uses primarily crime statistics, only the time, place, and type of crime, to predict where crimes will occur. Hunch Lab uses a wider range of data sources, including, for example, weather. And then Hitachi is a newer system that has a predictive crime analytics tool that also incorporates social media, the first one to my knowledge to do so. And these systems are in use in 50-plus cities in the US. So why do police departments buy this? So some police departments are interested in buying systems like this because they're marketed as impartial systems. So it's a way to police in an unbiased way. And so these companies make statements like this. By the way, the references will all be at the end and they'll be on the slides. So for example, the predictive crime analytics from Hitachi claims that the system is anonymous because it shows you an area. It doesn't show you, you know, to look for a particular person. And Predpol, you know, reassures people that it eliminates any liberties or profiling concerns. And Hunch Lab notes that the system fairly represents priorities for public safety and is unbiased by race or ethnicity, for example. So let's take a minute to describe in more detail what we mean when we talk about fairness. So when we talk about fairness, we mean a few things. So one is fairness with respect to individuals. So if I'm very similar to somebody and we go through some process and there is, you know, two very different outcomes to that process, we would consider that to be unfair. So we want similar people to be treated in a similar way. But there are, you know, certain protected attributes that we wouldn't want someone to discriminate based on. And so there's this other property, group fairness. So we can look at the statistical parity between groups based on gender, race, et cetera, and see if they're treated in a similar way. And we might not expect that in some cases, for example, if the base rates in each group are very different. And then there's also fairness in errors. So all predictive systems are going to make errors. And if the errors are concentrated, then that may also represent unfairness. And so this concern arose recently with Facebook because people with Native American names had their profiles flagged as fraudulent far more often than those with white American names. So these are the sorts of things that we worry about, and each of these are metrics, and if you're interested more, you should check those two papers out. So how can potential issues with predictive policing have implications for these principles? So one problem is the training data that's used. So some of these systems only use crime statistics. Other systems, you know, all of them use crime statistics in some way. So one problem is that crime databases contain only crimes that have been detected, right? So the police are only going to detect crimes that they know are happening, either through patrol and their own investigation or because they've been alerted to crime, for example, by a citizen calling the police. So a citizen has to feel like they can call the police, like that's a good idea. So some crimes suffer from this problem less than others. For example, gun violence is much easier to detect relative to fraud, for example, which is very difficult to detect. Now, the racial profiling aspect of this might come in because of biased policing in the past. So, for example, for marijuana arrests, black people are arrested in the US at rates four times that of white people. Even though there is statistical parity with these two groups to within a few percent. So this is where problems can arise. So let's go back to this geographic level predictive policing. So the danger here is that unless this system is very carefully constructed, this sort of crime area ranking might, again, become a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you send police officers to these areas, you further scrutinize them, and then again, you're only detecting a subset of crimes, and the cycle continues. So one obvious issue is that this statement about geographic-based crime prediction being anonymous is not true because race and location are very strongly correlated in the US. And this is something that machine learning systems can potentially learn. Another issue is that, for example, for individual fairness, what if my home sits within one of these boxes? Some of these boxes in these systems are very small. For example, Predpol, it's 500 feet by 500 feet. So it's maybe only a few houses. So the implications of the system are that you have police officers maybe sitting in a police cruiser outside your home, and a few doors down, someone may not be within that box and doesn't have this. So that may represent unfairness. So there are real questions here, and especially because there's no opt-out. There's no way to opt out of this system. If you live in a city that has this, then you have to deal with it. So it's quite difficult to find out what's really going on because the algorithm is secret. And in most cases, we don't know the full details of the inputs. We have some idea about what features are used, but that's about it. We also don't know the output. You know, that would be knowing police allocation, police strategies. And in order to nail down what's really going on here, in order to verify the validity of these companies' claims, it may be necessary to have a third party come in, examine the inputs and outputs of the system, and say concretely what's going on. And if everything is fine and dandy, then this shouldn't be a problem. So that's potentially one role that advocates can play. Maybe we should start pushing for audits of systems that are used in this way. These could have serious implications for people's lives. So we'll return to this idea a little bit later, but for now, this leads us nicely to transparency. So we want to know what these systems are doing. But it's very hard for the reasons described earlier. But even in the case of something like trying to understand Google's search algorithm, it's difficult because it's personalized. So by construction, each user is only seeing one endpoint. So it's a very isolating system. What do other people see? And one reason it's difficult to make some of these systems transparent is because of simply the complexity of the algorithms. So an algorithm can become so complex that it's difficult to comprehend even for the designer of the system or the implementer of the system. The designer might know that this algorithm maximizes some metric, say accuracy, but they may not always have a solid understanding of what the algorithm is doing for all inputs, certainly with respect to fairness. So in some cases, it might not be appropriate to use an extremely complex model. It might be better to use a simpler system with human interpretable features. Another issue that arises from the opacity of these systems and the centralized control is that it makes them very influential, and thus an excellent target for manipulation or tampering. So this might be tampering that is done from an organization that controls the system, or an insider at one of the organizations, or anyone who is able to compromise their security. So this is an interesting academic work that looked at the possibility of slightly modifying search rankings to shift people's political views. So since people are most likely to click on the top search results, so 90% of clicks go to the first page of search results, then perhaps by reshuffling things a little bit or maybe dropping some search results, you can influence people's views in a coherent way. And maybe you can make it so subtle that no one is able to notice. So in this academic study, they did an experiment in the 2014 Indian election. So they used real voters, and they kept the size of the experiment small enough that it was not going to influence the outcome of the election. So the researchers took people, they determined their political leaning, and they segmented them into control and treatment groups, where the treatment was manipulation of the search ranking results. And then they had these people browse the web. And what they found is that this mechanism is very effective at shifting people's voter preferences. So they, in this study, were able to introduce a 20% shift in voter preferences. Even alerting users to the fact that this was going to be done, so telling them we are going to manipulate your search results, really pay attention, they were totally unable to decrease the magnitude of the effect. So the margins of error in many elections is incredibly small, and the authors estimate that this shift could change the outcome of about 25% of elections worldwide if this were done. So, and the bias is so small that no one can tell. So all humans, no matter how sort of smart and resistant to manipulation we think we are, all of us are subject and to this sort of manipulation, and we really can't tell. So I'm not saying that this is occurring, but right now there is no regulation to stop this. There is no way that we could reliably detect this. So there's a huge amount of power here. So something to think about. But it's not only corporations that are interested in this sort of behavioral manipulation. So in 2010, UK Prime Minister David Cameron created this UK Behavioral Insights Team, which is informally called the Nudge Unit. And so what they do is they use behavioral science and this predictive analytics approach with experimentation to have people make better decisions for themselves in society as determined by the UK government. And as of a few months ago, after an executive order signed by Obama in September, the United States now has its own nudge unit. So to be clear, I don't think that this is some sort of malicious plot. I think that there can be huge value in these sorts of initiatives in positively impacting people's lives. But when this sort of behavioral manipulation is being done in part openly, oversight is pretty important. And we really need to consider what these systems are optimizing for. And that's something that we might not always know or at least understand. So for example, for industry, we do have a pretty good understanding there. Industry cares about optimizing for the time spent on the website. You know, Facebook wants you to spend more time on Facebook. They want you to click on ads, click on newsfeed items. They want you to like things. And fundamentally, profit. So already this has some pretty serious implications and has had pretty serious implications in the last 10 years in media, for example. You know, the optimizing for click-through rate in journalism has produced a race to the bottom in terms of quality. And another issue is that optimizing for what people like might not always be the best approach. So Facebook officials have said publicly about how Facebook's goal is to make you happy. They want you to open that news feed and just feel great. But there's an issue there, right? Because people get their news, you know, like 40% of people, according to Pew Research, get their news from Facebook. So if people don't want to, you know, people don't want to see war and corpses because it makes them feel sad. So this is not a system that is going to optimize for an informed population. It's not going to produce a population that is ready to engage in civic life. It's going to produce an amused population whose time is occupied by cat pictures. So in politics, we have a similar optimization problem that's occurring. So these political campaigns that use these predictive systems are optimizing for votes for the desired candidate, of course. So instead of a political campaign being maybe this is a naive view, but being an open discussion of the issues facing the country, it becomes this micro-targeted persuasion game. And the people that get targeted are a very small subset of all people, and it's only going to be the people that are, you know, they're on the edge, maybe they're disinterested. Those are the people that are going to get attention from political candidates. So, in policy, as with these nudge units, they're being used to enable better use of government services. So there are some good projects that have come out of this, increasing voter registration, improving health outcomes, improving education outcomes. But some of these predictive systems that we're starting to see in government are optimizing for compliance, as is the case with predictive policing. So this is something that we need to watch carefully. So I think this is a nice quote that sort of describes the problem. In some ways, we might be narrowing our horizon. And the danger is that these tools are separating people. And this is particularly bad for political action, because political action requires people to have shared experience and thus are able to collectively act to exert pressure to fix problems. So finally, accountability. So we need some oversight mechanisms. So for example, in the case of errors, so this is particularly important for civil or bureaucratic systems. So when an algorithm produces some decision, we don't always want humans to just defer to the machine, and that might represent one of the problems. So there are starting to be some cases of computer algorithms yielding a decision and then humans being unable to correct an obvious error. So there's this case in Georgia in the United States where two young people went to the Department of Motor Vehicles, they're twins, and they went to get their driver's license. However, they were both flagged by a fraud algorithm that uses facial recognition to look for similar faces. And I guess the people that designed the system didn't think of the possibility of twins. So this is one. So they just left without their driver's licenses. The people in the Department of Motor Vehicles were unable to correct this. So this is one implication. It's like something out of Kafka. But there are also cases of errors being made and people not noticing until after actions have been taken, some of them very serious, because people simply deferred to the machine. So this is an example from San Francisco. So an ALPR, an automated license plate reader, is a device that uses image recognition to detect and read license plates, and usually to compare license plates with a known list of plates of interest. And so San Francisco uses these, and they're mounted on police cars. So in this case, San Francisco ALPR got a hit on a car. And it was the car of a 47-year-old woman with no criminal history. And so it was a false hit because it was a blurry image, and it matched erroneously with one of the plates of interest that happened to be a stolen vehicle. So they conduct a traffic stop on her, and they take her out of the vehicle, they search her and the vehicle, she gets a pat down, and they have her kneel at gunpoint in the street. So how much oversight should be present depends sort of on the implications of the system. So it's certainly the case that for some of these decision-making systems, an error might not be that important. It could be relatively harmless. But in this case, an error in this algorithmic decision led to this totally innocent person literally having a gun pointed at her. So that brings us to, you know, we need some way of getting some information about what is going on here. We don't want to have to wait for these events before we are able to determine some information about the system. So auditing is one option to independently verify the statements of companies in situations where we have inputs and outputs. So for example, this could be done with Google, Facebook. If you have the inputs of a system, say you have test accounts or real accounts, maybe you can collect people's information together. So that was something that was done during the 2012 Obama campaign by ProPublica. People noticed that they were getting different emails from the Obama campaign and were interested to see, based on what factors, the emails were changing. And so I think about 200 people submitted emails, and they were able to determine some information about what the emails were being varied based on. So there have been some like successful attempts at this. So compare inputs and then look at why one item was shown to one user and not another, and see if there's any statistical differences. So there's, you know, some potential legal issues depending, you know, with the test accounts. So that's something to think about. I'm not a lawyer. So for example, if you want to examine ad targeting algorithms, one way to proceed is to construct a browsing profile and then examine what ads are served back to you. And so this is something that academic researchers have looked at, because at the time, at least, you didn't need to make an account to do this. So this was a study that was presented at Privacy Enhancing Technologies last year. And in this study, the researchers generate some browsing profiles that differ only by one characteristic. So they're basically identical in every way except for one thing, and that is this denoted by treatment one and two. So this is a randomized controlled trial, but I left out the randomization part for simplicity. So in one study, they applied a treatment of gender. So they had the browsing profiles in treatment one be male browsing profiles, and the browsing profiles in treatment two be female. And they wanted to see, is there any difference in the way that ads are targeted if browsing profiles are effectively identical except for gender? So it turns out that there was. So a third-party site was showing Google ads for senior executive positions at a rate 6 times higher to the fake men than for the fake women in this study. So this sort of auditing is not going to be able to determine everything that algorithms are doing, but they can sometimes uncover interesting, at least statistical differences. So this leads us to the fundamental issue. Right now, we're really not in control of some of these systems, and we really need these predictive systems to be controlled by us in order for them not to be used as a system of control. So there are some technologies that I'd like to point you all to that you know, we need tools in the digital commons that can help address some of these concerns. So the first thing is that, of course, we know that minimizing the amount of data available can help in some contexts, which we can do by making systems that are private by design and by default. Another thing is that these audit tools might be useful. And so these two nice examples in academia so the ad experiment that I just showed was done using AdFisher. So these are two toolkits that you can use to start doing this sort of auditing. Another technology that is generally useful, but particularly in the case of prediction, it's useful to maintain access to as many sites as possible through anonymity systems like Tor, because it's impossible to personalize when everyone looks the same. So this is a very important technology. Something that doesn't really exist, but that I think is pretty important, is having some tool to view the landscape. So as we know from these few studies that have been done, different people are not seeing the internet in the same way. So this is one reason why we don't like censorship. But rich and poor people, from academic research, we know that there is like widespread price discrimination on the internet. So rich and poor people see a different view of the internet. Men and women see a different view of the internet. We want to know how different people see the same site. And this could be the beginning of a defense system for the sort of manipulation tampering that I showed earlier. Another interesting approach is obfuscation, injecting noise into the system. So there's an interesting browser extension called Ad Nauseam, that's for Firefox, which clicks on every single ad you're served to inject noise. So that's, I think, an interesting approach that people haven't looked at too much. So in terms of policy, you know, Facebook and Google, these internet giants, have billions of users. And sometimes they like to call themselves new public utilities. And if that's the case, then it might be necessary to subject them to additional regulation. Another problem that's come up, for example, with some of the studies that Facebook has done is sometimes a lack of ethics review. So for example, in academia, if you're going to do research involving humans, there's an institutional review board that you go to that verifies that you're doing things in an ethical manner. And some companies do have internal review processes like this, but it might be important to have an independent ethics board that does this sort of thing. And we really need third-party auditing. So for example, some companies don't want auditing to be done because of IP concerns. And if that's the concern, maybe having a set of people that are not paid by the company to check how some of these systems are being implemented could help give us confidence that things are being done in a reasonable way. So, in closing, algorithmic decision-making is here, and it's barreling forward at a very fast rate. and we need to figure out what the guide rails should be and how to install them to handle some of the potential threats. There's a huge amount of power here. We need more openness in these systems. And right now, with the intelligent systems that do exist, we don't know what's occurring, really, and we need to watch carefully where and how these systems are being used. And I think this community has an important role to play in this fight, to study what's being done, to show people what's being done, to raise the debate and advocate, and where necessary, to resist. Thanks.
So let's have a question and answer. Microphone two, please.
Hi there. Thanks for the talk. Since these pre-crime softwares also arrived here in Germany with the start of the so-called cobweb system in southern Germany and Bavaria, Nuremberg especially, where they tried to predict burglary crime using that criminal record geographical analysis like you explained, leads me to a twofold question. First, have you heard of any research that measures the effectiveness of such measures at all? And second, what do you think of the game theory if the thieves or the bad guys know of the system and when they game the system, and they will probably win? Since one police officer in an interview said the system is used to reduce the personal costs at policing, so they just send the guys where the red flags are and the others take the day off.
So with respect to testing the effectiveness of predictive policing, so the companies, some of them do randomized controlled trials and claim a reduction in policing. The best sort of independent study that I've seen is by this RAND Corporation that did a study in, I think, Shreveport, Louisiana. And in their report, they claim that there was no statistically significant difference. Like, they didn't find any reduction, and it was specifically looking at property crime, which I think you mentioned. So I think right now, you know, there's sort of conflicting reports between the independent auditors and these company claims. So there definitely needs to be more study. Yeah, and then the second thing, sorry, remind me, what was the second thing?
What about the guys gaming the system?
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah, I think it's a legitimate concern. Like, if all the outputs were just immediately public, then yes, everyone knows the location of all police officers, and I imagine that people would have a problem with that. Yep.
Microphone number four, please.
Yeah, this is actually not a question, but just a comment. I've enjoyed your talk very much, in particular after watching the talk in Hall 1 early in the afternoon. They say hi to your new boss about algorithms that are trained with big data and finally make decisions. And I think these two talks get kind of are complementary. And if people are interested in that topic, they might want to check out the other talk and watch it later, because these fit very well together.
Yeah, it was a great talk.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Microphone number two, please.
You mentioned the need to have some kind of third-party auditing or some kind of way to peek into these algorithms and to see what they're doing and to see if they're being fair. I mean, can you talk a little bit more about that? Like, going forward, I mean, some kind of regulatory structures would probably have to emerge to, you know, analyze and to look at these black boxes that are just sort of popping up everywhere and, you know, controlling more and more of the things that in our lives, important decisions. And so just, I mean, what kind of discussions are there for that, and what kind of possibility is there for that? And, you know, I'm sure that companies would be very, very resistant to any kind of attempt to look into their algorithms and to,
Yeah, I mean, definitely companies would be very resistant to having people look into their algorithms. So if you want to do a very rigorous audit of what's going on, then it's probably necessary to have, you know, a few people come in and sign NDAs and then look through the systems. So that's one way to proceed. But another way to proceed that, you know, so these academic researchers have done a few experiments and found some interesting things, and that's sort of all the attempts at auditing that we've seen. You know, there's one attempt in 2012 with the Obama campaign, but there's really not been any sort of systematic attempt. You know, like in censorship, we see a systematic attempt to do measurement as often as possible, check what's going on, and that itself, you know, can act as an oversight mechanism. But right now, you know, I think these many of these companies realize no one's watching, so there's no real push to have people verify, are you being fair when you implement this system, because no one's really checking.
I mean, do you think that at some point it would be like an FDA or an SEC, I mean, to give some American examples, an actual government regulatory agency that has the power and the ability to, you know, not just sort of look and try to reverse engineer some of these algorithms, and but actually peek in there and make sure that things are fair, because it seems like there's just, it's so important now that it's, again, it could be, you know, the difference between life and death, between getting a job, not getting a job, being pulled over, not being pulled over, being racially profiled, not racially profiled, things like that.
I mean, right.
Is it moving in that direction, or is it way too early for it?
I mean, so some people have, so like someone has called for like a federal search commission or like a federal algorithms commission that would do this sort of oversight work. But I mean, it's in such early stages right now that there's no sort of real push for that. But it's, I think it's a good idea.
And again, number two, please.
Thank you again for your talk. I was just curious if you can point to any examples of either current producers or consumers of these algorithmic systems who are actively and publicly trying to do so in a responsible manner by describing what they're trying to do and how they're going about it.
So, yeah, so there are some companies, for example, like DataKind, that try to do deploy algorithmic systems in as responsible way as possible for like public policy. Like, I actually also implement systems for public policy in a transparent way, like all the code is in GitHub, et cetera. And it is also the case, to give credit to Google and these giants, they're trying to implement transparency systems that help you understand, you know, this has been done with respect to how your data is being collected. But, for example, you know, if you go on Amazon.com, you can see, oh, a recommendation has been made, and that is pretty transparent. You can see this item was recommended to me, so you know that prediction is being used in this case, and it will say why prediction is being used, because you purchased some item. And Google has a similar thing. If you go to like Google Ad settings, you can even turn off personalization of ads if you want, and you can also see some of the inferences that have been learned about you, a subset of the inferences that have been learned about you, so like what interests.
A question from the internet, please.
Yes, Billet Q is asking, how do you avoid biases in machine learning? A resume analysis system, for example, could be biased against women and minorities if used for hiring decisions based on known data.
Yeah, so one thing is to just explicitly check. So you can check to see how, you know, positive outcomes are being distributed among those protected classes. You could also incorporate these sort of fairness constraints in the function that you optimize when you train the system. And so if you're interested in reading more about this, the two papers, so let me get a references. There's a good paper called Fairness Through Awareness that describes how to go about doing this. So I recommend this person read that. It's good.
Thank you.
Microphone two, please.
Thanks again for your talk. Better? Okay. I see, of course, a problem with all the black boxes that you described with regards for the crime systems, but when we look at the advertising systems, in many cases, they are very networked. There are many different systems collaborating and exchanging data via open APIs. RESTful APIs and various demand-side platforms and audience exchange platforms and everything. So can that help to at least increase awareness on where targeting, personalization, might be happening. I mean, I'm looking at systems like BuiltWith that surface what kind of JavaScript libraries are used elsewhere. So is that something that could help at least to give a better awareness and listing all the points where you might be targeted?
I mean, so like with respect to advertising, the fact that there is behind the scenes this like complicated auction process that's occurring just makes things a lot more complicated. So for example, you know, I said briefly that, oh, they found that there's this, you know, statistical difference between how men and women are treated, but it doesn't necessarily mean that, oh, the algorithm is definitely biased. It could be because of this auction process, it could be that women are considered more valuable when it comes to advertising, and so these executive ads are getting outbid by some other ads. And so there's a lot of potential causes for that. So I think it just makes things a lot more complicated. I don't know if it helps with the bias at all.
Well, the question was more in direction, can it help to surface and make people aware of that fact? I mean, I can talk to my kids probably, they will probably understand, but I can't explain that to my grandma, who's also looking at an iPad.
So the fact that the systems are, I don't know if I understand.
Okay, I think the main problem is that we are behind the industry efforts to being targeted at, and many people do know, but a lot more people don't know, and making them aware of the fact that they are target,
right,
in a way, is something that it can only be shown via third parties that dispose that data and make audits in a way, maybe in an automated way.
Right. Yeah, I think it certainly could help with advocacy, if that's the point, yeah.
Another question from the internet, please.
Yes, on IRC, they are asking, if we know that prediction in some cases provides an influence that cannot be controlled, so R4v5 would like to know from you if there are some cases or areas where machine learning simply shouldn't go.
So I think I think that it is the case that in some cases machine learning might not be appropriate. For example, if you use machine learning to decide who should be searched. Like, I don't think it should be the case that a machine learning algorithm should ever be used to determine probable cause or something like that. So if it's just one piece of evidence that you consider and there's human oversight always, maybe it's fine. But we should be very suspicious and hesitant in certain contexts where the ramifications are very serious, you know, like the no-fly list and so on.
And number two again.
A second question that just occurred to me, if you don't mind. Until the advent of algorithmic systems, when there have been cases of serious harm that's been resulted to individuals or groups, and it's been demonstrated that it's occurred because of an individual or a system of people being systematically biased, then often one of the actions that's taken is pressure is applied, and then people are required to change. Be held responsible and then change the way that they do things to try to remove bias from that system. What's the current thinking about how we can go about doing that when the systems that are doing that are algorithmic? Is it just going to be human oversight and the humans are going to have to be held responsible for the oversight?
So in terms of bias, I mean, if we're concerned about bias towards particular types of people, that's something that we can optimize for. So we can train systems that are unbiased in this way. So that's one way to deal with it. But there's always going to be errors. So that's sort of a separate issue from the bias. And in the case where there are errors, there must be oversight. So one way that one could improve the way that this is done is by making sure that you're keeping track of confidence of decisions. So, you know, if you have a low confidence prediction, then maybe a human should come in and check things. So that might be one way to proceed.
So there's no more question. I close this talk now. Thank you very much. And a big applause to Jennifer Helsby.